Nocturne Productions presents Tales from the Dark Waves, a gothic horror anthology series created by Cole Burgett. Listener discretion is advised.
Tales from the Dark Waves. Episode 1, Eliza Dawn. Narrated by Bonnie Bogovich. Starring Ryan Mercier, Andrew Murano, and Alvin Daramola-Rose. Written and directed by Cole Burgett. Somewhere in the Sargasso Sea, 1911. Captain Buttermere sat alone in his cabin, listening to the old ship creaking and moaning all around him. The last bottle of brandy from his personal stash lay at his feet, shifting between them as the ship rocked with the rhythm of the waves. He could hear the grumbling of a few men outside the cabin door and knew that mutiny was on the horizon. But he dared not step foot on deck. Not until dawn lit the skies, and he was sure that they were well beyond the waters of the Sargasso and cruising the North Atlantic Current. The knock at the cabin door that tore him from his thoughts was a familiar one. While holed up in his cabin, he permitted entry to only one man, his first mate, Mr. Mason. It was his knock.
"Come ahead."
He heard Mason's key turn over in the lock. Then the door swung open, and Mason entered.
"Captain Buttermere."
"What is it, Mr. Mason?"
"The fog is still heavy, and this storm has the sea worked up something awful, but the rigging is secured. Taylor is on watch."
"Thank you, Mr. Mason. Is that all?"
"Aye, sir."
"Very well. Good night."
Though dismissed, Mason did not leave. Instead, he stood riveted to the floor, his eyes shifting nervously in their sockets.
"Out with it, Mr. Mason. Speak your mind."
Mason chose his words carefully.
"Well, sir, the crew have taken notice of your absence. They have questions, and I'm afraid I'm at a loss as to what to tell them."
The captain glared at him.
"There is talk among the greener hands who have not sailed with you for as long as I. There are whispers of mutiny."
"There will be no mutiny aboard this ship. Let me be very clear about that."
"Then please, Captain Buttermere, tell me why you've locked yourself away in this cabin for days on end."
Buttermere heaved a ragged sigh. He had known that Mason would ask sooner or later the reason for his madness, and he supposed that now was as good a time as any to finally tell him the story. He shoved the chair nearest him ajar with his boot.
"Sit down, Mr. Mason. How long have we sailed together?"
7 years, Captain."
"And you have been my first mate for the last two?"
"Aye."
"In that time, we have sailed upon many waters together."
"Aye, sir, we have."
"But we have never sailed upon these waters."
Buttermere's eyes leered at Mason, and something like a dark shadow passed over his face.
"Since I was a boy, my life's ambition has been to captain my own vessel. That chance first came to me right here, in the heart of the Sargasso."
"While I appreciate that, Captain, I'm afraid I fail to see how this'll help me explain to the men why you refuse to leave your cabin."
"I remain here because I know what is out there, moving through the fathoms and unsoundable depths. I know, Mr. Mason, because my first command was the Eliza Dawn."
"The Eliza Dawn? I've never heard of her."
"Aye, few have. And fewer still among the living. I saw to that myself when I struck her name from the record after I sank her."
Forgive me my disbelief, Captain Buttermere. You sank your first command.
I sank her, and without a shred of remorse. Her bones are still out here somewhere, I imagine, haunting the gloomy deep. But it is not the carcass of the Eliza Dawn that keeps me under lock and key, Mr. Mason. No, I was able to sink her and many of those dark memories all those years ago. It is the thing that I could not send to the depths as a lifeless husk alongside her that still haunts me.
Thing, Captain? What thing?
Buttermere packed his pipe and struck a match. As the smoke swirled about the cabin, he began his tale.
I was a young man at the time, no older than yourself, sailing as first mate aboard a schooner called the Sabalo. The skipper was an old salt Spaniard named Daza. We were sailing through these very waters one evening when a heavy fog moved in. The lookout spotted a pair of sails off our port and called it down to us. The skipper took a look through the spyglass, then passed it off to me to see what I could make of it. That was when I saw her, the Eliza Dawn. Sails unfurled and not at anchor, but not moving, like she was run up on a reef, and not one crewman in sight. Now, that fog was thick as a blanket, and made navigation damn near impossible. So, the skipper had me take two men and put to boat, row over, and see what there was to see. I took the bosun, a big man from Virginia named Anders, who swore he could talk to ships. He was that good of a bosun, and knew sailing vessels inside and out. And the other man I took was a young hand I had befriended and convinced to join the crew while at port in Barbados. He was smart, educated, despite being born on a plantation down there. He had many names, that was their custom, as he explained it to me once, but the name he gave us was Friday. And there we went, me, Anders, and Friday, across to the Eliza Dawn. As we got closer to her, we noticed the Sargasso getting thicker. Anders was rowing and complained about it. "Welcome to the Sargasso Sea," I told him. "When the waters are clear and blue, peering into them is like looking through clean glass. But the gulf weed here is thick and heavy and sometimes obscures the depths. Sargassum, the Portuguese call it. And Mr. Mason, I tell you, it was thick that day. In thin lines, the weed is not so much trouble, as you know. But trying to navigate the denser pockets would drive the devil himself to repentance. Friday knew what I was talking about.
I remember scraping it off the beaches of Barbados as a boy, near the plantation. There would be mounds of it all down the shoreline, like mountains of yellow and brown.
And that's just about what it looked like that day. Mountains of yellow and brown. It wasn't a reef that held the Eliza Dawn in place, but that damned weed. We had never seen anything like it. And the smell. Ugh. My God, the smell. At first, I assumed it was coming from dead fish entangled in the weed. But that theory would be woefully short-sighted, as I would soon learn. Well, the closer we got to the Eliza Dawn, the harder it became for Anders to row. We finally just had to put Friday up to throwing a line across the ship's bow and pull ourselves the rest of the way. We waited for the ship to dip down on the back of a wave and heaved ourselves up and over the side. The deck was empty, and with that fog obscuring most everything in sight, let me tell you, Mr. Mason, it was downright chilling. There was not a man, one aboard that ship. I sent Anders to check the holds and inspect the hull, while Friday accompanied me to the captain's cabin, We found it locked. I knocked and called out and waited, but no one came. Now, Friday was a much bigger man than I, so I told him to see what he could do about that door. He broke it in easy enough, but as soon as that door opened, the smell hit us even more strongly. Have you ever smelled the stench of death, Mr. Mason?
Aye, Captain Hayes. Not a stench one ever forgets.
You are not wrong. Well, we smelled it that day. And it was strong enough that we tore our shirts to make coverings for our faces before we entered the cabin. Inside, we found the source of that stench, the one coming from the cabin, at least. Two bodies seated quite like we are now, one across from the other. The flesh was rotted, but I could see clear enough that one of them had been shot through the chest. I said as much, and Friday went to the other body and found a gun lying on the floor, just below where the dead man's hand hovered. He picked it up and inspected it.
Look, Mr. Buttermere, two bullets are missing.
Well, that confirmed what I suspected. The one man, likely Captain, given the manner of his dress, had shot the other before turning the gun on himself. But there did not appear to be any sign of struggle. It would have been as if I shot you, Mr. Mason, right here and now.
I would greatly appreciate it if you did no such thing, Captain Buttermere.
Yes, well, Friday walked over to the man who had been shot and began checking his pockets.
Mr. Buttermere, he's got something in his hand. A note.
He pried that scrap of paper from the dead man's fingers. We looked at it, but the ink was faded. No way of knowing what he wrote. Though I have speculated much about it in years since. I checked the ship's logs, but there was nothing out of the ordinary. The entries simply stopped on a Tuesday 2 months prior to when we found the ship. Anyway, we regrouped with Anders, who told us he found no problems with the hull, but that there was not a trace of any other crewmen aboard, apart from those two bodies. And two bodies, mind you, would not have been enough to crew that vessel. The ship was abandoned. Not even the boats had been taken down from their mounts. So back we went to the Sabalo. We told Captain Daza everything we found. He decided it best to clear out the Sargassum and haul the Eliza Dawn back in and let the port authorities sort out the whole affair. That's when he gave me my first command. With the Sabalo as our escort, I was to captain the Eliza Dawn safely back to port. I took four men with me for the skeleton crew, including Friday, and headed back to that ghost of a ship.
Buttermere paused long enough to shake out the tobacco from his pipe and repack it. He struck another match and kept talking.
While Friday and I wrapped the two dead bodies in some old sailcloth we found, I tasked the other three with clearing out the Sargassum from the base of the ship. They cursed and complained something awful, which I understood how badly that gulf weed smelled. But I paid them little mind until one of them screamed. Friday and I raced to the side of the ship and looked down. Though it was difficult to see through the fog and night was approaching, we could just make out what it was that had startled the man. It was not fish we were smelling, Mr. Mason. It was a body.
Trapped in the gulf weed?
Aye, but it was not alone. There were others.
Mason's eyes went wide with shock.
It was the crew. The crew of the Eliza Dawn.
Ensnared in the Sargassum and drowned.
But how? I mean, what could have caused that?
Buttermere waved a hand through the smoke.
Just listen. Well, after we cleared the weed and the bodies from the base of the ship, we sent the bodies from the captain's cabin to the depths. By then, night was upon us, but we were ready to sail. The fog was still heavy, so we had to use lanterns to signal to the Sabalo. When we finally got underway, I left a man at the helm and another on watch and retired to the cabin. We were all on edge and disturbed. Sleep came, but it was an uneasy, troubled sleep. I don't know how much time passed before I was roused up by Friday banging at the door.
Mr. Buttermere, come quick. We've lost the watchman.
Lost him? I shouted. What do you mean we lost him?
He's gone, sir. Vanished.
Now I'll tell you, Mr. Mason, that should have been my first clue that something was very, very wrong. But this was my first command, and I was not about to abandon it mere hours after stepping into a captain's boots. We determined it was a heavy fog and the unfamiliar layout of the ship that most likely led to the watchman making a misstep and tumbling overboard. The helmsman said he saw nothing. We considered going back to search for our lost man, but the lights of the Sabala were dim, and we could barely make her out through the fog. There was no way of knowing when or where the watchman had fallen, so I stationed a man in his place and went back to the cabin, eager for the light of the morning to do away with the haze of the night. It was not an hour later that I was roused yet again by Friday.
It's the Sabalo, sir. We've lost sight of her.
I went tearing out of the cabin, and sure enough, old Daza's ship was nowhere in sight. It seemed the fog had gotten thicker somehow. And to make matters worse, no sooner had I cleared the cabin than did the ship lurch and send us all to our hands and knees upon the deck. It was like some great hand had reached up from the depths and caught us. We held lanterns over the side and could just make out the Sargassum that had clustered up around our hull. We had sailed into another patch of weed that had slowed us. While Daza and the Sabalo sailed on, that was the only explanation. I let the helmsman have it, but he swore he had sailed into no such weed and had followed the sailing patterns marked by the lights of the Sabalo as closely as he could. While I stood there puzzling over how to get us out of that rut, we heard it for the first time. It was the sweetest, strangest sound that seemed to come from everywhere and nowhere at once. It might have been coming from the fog, or from the sea, or from the ship itself. A song, Mr. Mason. That's the only way I know how to describe it.
A song, Captain Buttermere?
Aye, a song. That soothed us and chilled us to the bone at the same time. And while we all stood there listening to it, I'll be damned if one of my other men didn't walk right over to the side of the ship and throw himself over the railing.
He threw himself overboard?
Aye. And by the time we got to the side of the ship, he was already swallowed by the weed. With the first watchman already missing, that left me with only Friday and the helmsman. Well, at that point, Mr. Mason, I am not above admitting we were three grown men scared out of our wits. Lost at sea, hung up in a cluster of Sargassum, surrounded by a fog so thick It nearly obscured the lights of the lanterns in our hands. We retreated to the cabin and holed up there. Friday looked at me, and by that point, we both had inklings of what had transpired in there before we ever came aboard. What the devil was that singing we heard, Friday?
Have you ever heard a tale of Odysseus, Mr. Buttermere?
Now is not the time for tales, Friday. No sooner had I spoken those words, we heard that wicked melody once again, this time bleeding through the cabin walls. The last man who was with us, the helmsman, Thompson was his name, threw open the cabin doors and started out onto the deck. The look in his eyes was deranged, as if he had lost all sense of agency and willpower. Friday went after him while I retrieved the dead captain's revolver. When I emerged from the cabin, the two of them were wrestling on the deck. Enough! I shouted. That's an order! But it was an order he heeded not, and promptly hurled himself overboard. There was nothing we could do for him. The gulf we'd had him. I fired into the fog, hoping to scare away whatever was the source of that hypnotic melody. What is this madness that has taken hold of my crew, Friday? Well, the big man raced for the cabin. I followed him inside and he slammed the door shut.
As I said, Mr. Buttermere, the story of Odysseus. As he sailed from Circe's island, he encountered the sirens and their baleful songs threatening to lure his sailors to their deaths.
And did this Odysseus character survive this encounter?
Only by plugging his ears and the ears of his crew.
That's it? That's all it takes?
Well, Mr. Buttermere, it is only a myth, but one that would seem appropriate given our present circumstances.
So, we tore up a couple shreds of cloth and used them to stuff our ears. Then we sat down in the cabin and waited. We knew not what else to do. The sarcasm would have to be cleared before we sail. And even then, the two of us would not have been enough to get the ship to port. Our only hope rested with the coming dawn and the possible return of Captain Daza.
So? What did you do?
We waited. And by then we knew what had led the old captain to do what he did. And I confess the thought of doing the same crossed both our minds. To pass the time, I checked the logs once again. But whatever had happened to the former crew of the Eliza Dawn had apparently happened with such speed that our captain had been afforded no time to keep record of it. As I said, the entry simply stopped. By then, I was exhausted and tried to find sleep. Just as I was about to take hold of it, I could hear that song again. And then, Mr. Mason, it was like my world went black. When I next came around, sunlight was bleeding in through the windows and the open cabin door. I found that my hands and legs had been bound to the chair. Friday, however, was nowhere to be seen. I called for him for an hour, but he never came. Eventually, it became clear to me what had happened. I later learned, when I discovered the old tales for myself, that he had neglected to tell me about Odysseus lashing himself to the mast of his ship to prevent himself from being lulled to his death. I must have fallen into some kind of trance when I heard that song again, and Friday had done what he could to save me, but I suppose he could not have saved himself. I often wonder if he knew as much, and that is why he did not tell me about Odysseus and the mast. If he had somehow been afraid that I would have ordered him to allow me to tie him up and thus saved him while sacrificing myself. In truth, I don't know what I would have done. But what I know now is that I owe Friday and his knowledge of old myths my life. It was some hours later when a figure darkened the doorway. Anders, the bosun aboard the Sabalo. Old Captain Daza had returned to search for us. Anders cut me loose, and I told him we had to get away from that ship as quickly as we could. We returned to the Sabalo, and I made a fool of myself in front of the skipper, raving like a lunatic, I'm sure. But I suppose it was the sincerity of my madness and the fact that all the other hands I had taken with me were gone that convinced him there was something wrong with the Eliza Dawn. At my insistence, he sank her.
Buttermere reached inside of his coat pocket and pulled out a folded-up sheet of paper. He tossed it on the table between himself and Mason.
That is the page of Captain Daza's log containing all references to the Eliza Dawn. I tore it out the day we reached port so that no one would go looking for her.
Mason's eyes flickered down at the paper, but he did not reach for it.
What do you think it was, Captain, that drove Friday and those men to their deaths?
Buttermere thought about it for a long moment. Then he gave the smallest of shrugs.
Sirens? Hysteria? Madness? Who knows, Mr. Mason? But whatever it was, it remains out there in the deep, hidden beneath the shroud of night and fog.
And the scrap of paper you found in the dead man's hand. What do you think was written there before the ink faded?
Buttermere opened his mouth to respond, but as he did so, a flash of light through the porthole caught his eye. A look of respite came upon his face, a feeling of relief washing over him.
Look, Mr. Mason, the dawn, and not a moment too soon.
Nocturne Productions presents Tales from the Dark Waves. This episode was narrated by Bonnie Bogovich and features the vocal talents of Ryan Mercier as Captain Buttermere, Andrew Murano as Mason, and Alvin Daramola-Rose as Friday. This episode was written and directed by Cole Burgett. Follow Nocturne Productions on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at NocturnePodPro. For just a few dollars per month, consider becoming a patron by visiting www.patreon.com/nocturneproductions.